Welcome to the Christian House of Prayer's midweek service. Tonight's message is entitled, The Same Spirit of Faith, from our beloved Bishop Nate Holcomb.
In the book of 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13, we have in the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe and therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. Lift up your voice and declare the word of the Lord with me. We have in the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe and therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers and the hearers and doers of his word. And all God's people said amen.
Amen.
And amen. Come on, get somebody high five. Tell them it's all about him. You may have your seats in the presence of our life-changing King. Wow, what a joy it is to be able to come to you wherever you're viewing this telecast of It's All About Him. And we are delighted and excited that the Lord has trusted us to be one of the voices on television where you're watching to speak to your issues. Today we're coming from 2 Corinthians chapter 4 in the 13th verse. We're going to talk about the same spirit of faith. Can the congregation say that? The same spirit of faith. Now, this is coined for the Christian House of Prayer, the Cathedral of Central Texas. It's coined the Year of the Bow, coming from 2 Samuel chapter 1 and the 19th verse. David is prophesying after the death of King Saul and his sons, and David makes this declaration. He's not asking a question. He makes it as a declaration, and David says, how are the mighty fallen? That's in 2 Samuel chapter 1, verse 19. How are the mighty fallen? And then he goes on in verse 25 and he makes the declaration again the second time, but this time he adds on. He says, how are the mighty fallen in the midst of the battle? And then he concludes it in the 25th verse by saying, how are the mighty fallen and the weapons of war perish? But he tells us before he makes the declaration how the mighty falls. And that is in the 17th verse, or actually the 18th verse, he says, teach the children of Judah, which is praise, the use of the bow. And so the use of the bow is what we're talking about in the year of 2007, which happens to be the ministry of the Holy Spirit. We discovered that Jesus, he is the archer, and you and I, as servants, we are the arrows that he sends forth. Isaiah says, in response to the Lord asking this question, whom may we send and who will go for us? And Isaiah said, here am I, shoot me. So we're the arrows. And what I mean by arrows, in terms of our prayers, in terms of our lifestyle, and in terms of our confession and even our faith, we are the arrows. But we need the Holy Spirit, because the Bible says, it's not by might nor by power, but it's by my spirit, saith the Lord of hosts. And so without the Holy Spirit, we cannot properly testify, magnify, and glorify the Lord Jesus Christ. For that is the spirit of God's ministry. He would never take glory for himself. The spirit would never pull in attention on himself. It would always be how that it's all about him. And so when we talk about the Holy Spirit's ministry, we're talking about becoming more or better acquainted with the Holy Spirit so that we can testify, magnify, and glorify God, and to God be the glory. Can I hear you say amen? And so when we talk about the same spirit of faith, we are moving from the seven sins against the Holy Spirit that we dealt with last week. And this week we want to talk about the ministry of the Holy Spirit as it relates to having the same spirit of faith. Notice again what he says in verse 13. We having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe and therefore have I spoken. We also believe in what? Therefore speak. Now, when we talk about the same spirit of faith, we're not talking about cloning little Nate Holcombs, God forbid. But I pray that what's on the inside of me and what's on the inside of you in terms of the Lord Jesus Christ, upon receiving him as our Savior, that he would be manifested through our lives. And what we want in the Christian House of Prayer, the Cathedral of Central Texas, we don't want to be a crowd, we want to be an army. And the difference between a crowd and an army, if you will, one of the things is that an army is organized and an army understands order. And so when we talk about the same spirit of faith, I think about the same spirit of faith as it relates to flavor. In every ministry, there's a certain flavor, and God uses that flavor through the manifestation of the Spirit through his leader, based upon the leader, based upon the leader's style. Are you with me?
Yes, sir.
Now, mine just happened to be vanilla. I told you before, you know. And it doesn't mean that vanilla is better than strawberry or vanilla is better than chocolate. I just like vanilla. All of it is ice cream. And mine just happened to be vanilla. And so when people come and join the Christian House of Prayer, it's because they like vanilla. Now those who don't like vanilla, they go at another church that's serving the kind of flavor. This is what he's talking about. You got to have the same spirit of faith. Now, I said that to say my favorite verse of scripture in all the Bible, you should know it by heart, right? Matthew's Gospel chapter 16, starting with the 13th verse, and it says it this way. And when Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? And then they begin to say, well, some say that thou art John the Baptist, Elijah, Jeremiah, or one of the prophets. But then Jesus says, now that's what they're saying. So they have a different flavor. Who do you say that I am? And Peter says, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. Now watch this. And Jesus says, and thou art Peter, or Petros, or little stone that can easily be moved, shaken, and thrown. But then he says, upon who he is, I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail. And when he said the gates of hell shall not prevail, he was talking about that the kingdom of darkness, the gates of hell, will not be able to stop the on flow of God's church and the movement of God's Spirit. See, the church is never to be in a retreating posture. Now, we got good defense, but we're not on the defense. We always move on the offense. Are you with me? In other words, we move it forward. We're taking, glory to God, we're taking nothing from the devil, but we're taking everything back from him. Hallelujah. Taking back what he stole from us. Now, here's the key. Jesus said, upon this rock, and that rock is revelation. And what we have discovered and what this church is built upon is revelation from the Father. Because Jesus said, flesh and blood did not reveal this unto you, but my Father. No one gets saved without the Father revealing the Son. We had this morning, several people responded to the altar call and came forth unto the Lord Jesus Christ and gave their life to Jesus. That's a supernatural phenomenon. And even though you may think, well, that is easy, you just come. No, you cannot come unless the Spirit of God draws you. And Jesus said, all that the Father give to me, they will come to me. And they that come to me, I will in no wise reject them or throw them away, no matter what it is. And so we had a supernatural phenomenon already this morning. Now, I said that to say, no one could say that Jesus Christ is Lord, the Bible says, except by the Holy Spirit. And you would think, well, people say Jesus is Lord. No, I'm talking about by way of revelation. See, you can say Jesus is Lord and still haven't said he's Lord. Because let everyone that named the name of Christ depart or come out of their sin from iniquity. So it's not only what we say with our mouths, but our lives become a letter and a testimony that God lives on the inside of Nate Holcomb. Hallelujah. And so therefore, when we talk about this revelation, it's a revelation from the Father, but then second of all, it's revelation of confession. What am I talking about? We're strong about talking the word of God. We're strong about saying what God says. Confession, homologeo, what does it mean? Homo is? Legeo, speak. We speak the same thing God says. And the whole idea of the devil is to shut your mouth up. Because if you shut up, then God can't operate what he wants to operate in your lives. Because he watches over his word to perform it. So therefore, we speak the same thing God speaks. This ain't some Eastern occult. When we talk about confession, we're talking about saying what God says. And what Jesus said to Peter, he said, Peter, you're smarter than what you look. Glory to God. Why? Because you heard the Father said it, and you said what the Father said. That's all confession is saying what God says. And you will see, as it were, the result even this morning. We're in two services, and the church is filled up. It's not going to happen by incident, accident, nor coincidence, but by the providence of God. And when we tap into the same spirit of faith, we get the same results. Now, here's the key to where I'm going with this. He says that we have the Same spirit of faith. This morning, I introduced the word at the end of the service, and I want to take the time out to introduce this word at the beginning of the service. The Prices, praise the Lord. This precious couple are visiting with us, and they stayed over for the second service. They did so well encouraging this preacher. Seemed like our congregation was a little slow this morning, so they stayed back to help encourage me again. Give God praise. It's good to have the Prices with us. I believe it is Detroit? Riverside, California, praise the Lord. I met some folk from Detroit this morning as well. Here's the key though. I introduced this word, pneuma is spirit. The word spirit is the Greek word pneuma. And this is one of Valerie's favorite words. It's called what, Valerie? Pneumatikos. Pneumatikos. Pneuma is spirit. Pneumatikos is spiritual. Now pay close attention to this, because faith takes us into the spirit world, or the realm of the spirit, or the invisible world. You have a visible world and an invisible world, and we'll talk about it. Faith is what moves you into that dimension or that invisible world. Now, pneumatikos is spiritual. Pneuma, spirit. Pneumatikos is spiritual. We are spiritual people. Now, I say that to say this. Usually, we think of ourselves in terms of human beings. Well, what are we, Bishop? Well, see, that's the thing. Because the Bible tells us that we're spirit, soul, and body. God says, let us make man in our image after our likeness. So God made us spiritual beings because Jesus said in John's Gospel chapter 4, talking to the woman at the well, Jesus said that God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. God is a spirit. So when God made man in his image after his likeness, God made us spiritual beings. We are spiritual beings, spirit, soul, and we live inside of a physical body. Now, what am I saying? You see, the average person, we become so, how should I say, human conscience, because we say we're human beings. Biblically speaking, we're not human beings. We're spiritual beings having human encounters. My goodness. I'm going to work with this side over here, Prices. I said, we're spiritual beings. See, you have to see yourself as God sees you. See, God made us in his image after his likeness. In other words, you see, God, he doesn't look like us. We look like God.
Amen. Amen. Amen.
There is a revelation of a difference. And so we're spiritual beings having human encounters. God is a spirit. And it took God, a spiritual being, to create and make the world as we know it today. Are you with me? So the spirit realm is more real than the physical realm. Because who I'm looking at it, when I look at Sister Sandra, I'm only looking at the house that she lives in. She's really on the inside. Hallelujah. See, we're spiritual beings having human encounters. Now, what difference does it make, somebody would ask? What difference does it make? See, we should be more comfortable and more at ease in the spirit than we are in the flesh. But the average person is so fleshly, it's difficult for them to make the transition and get in the spirit. Because from the spirit, you move from the inside out. But the flesh, you're always moving from the outside trying to get in. Are y'all all right over here? Then let me go and pick on them a little bit over here. All right, praise the Lord. Now, here's where we are with this, because we want to be so natural in the spirit, per se. We want to be able to just flow and walk with God and talk with God. And when you do that, you have to do it by faith. Faith is the key that brings you into that other dimension. Now, notice again what it says. This is 2 Corinthians chapter 4. Are you here? The 13th verse. Lift up your voice and declare the word of the Lord. Come on. We have in the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. So the same spirit of faith, the same spirit of faith believes and speaks. Say, believe and speak. One more time. Believe and speak with authority. Believe and speak. So the same spirit of faith. He said, we have the same spirit of faith as it is written. Where was it written? Psalms 116 and the 10th verse. It was written there. I believe therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. So the same spirit of faith, it believes and speaks. Or another way of saying, we speak what we believe. See, now the preacher's job, in essence, it's to get people to believe in what they say they believe in. See, all of us in here, for the most part, we would say, you know, I believe the Bible, especially if you're saved. I believe the Word of God. I believe the Bible. I believe the Word of God. But we don't know all the Word of God. I don't know all the Word of God. And I'm the preacher, and I know you're much smarter than I am. And you don't know all the Word. But we already have agreed, and we have already sealed the fact that we believe the book. And whatever's in the book, I believe it. Now, here are seven ingredients. Watch it now. Here are seven components that make up the same spirit of faith. And that's what I want. I want the same spirit that Paul's talking about. Same spirit of faith. You want to write these seven things down. Here are seven components that make up the same spirit of faith. Somebody's world is getting ready to change. Glory to God. I'm so excited about this. Hallelujah. I tell you, I am so excited about this. This morning, Elder Flakes, this morning, before I woke up, I was dreaming about whipping the devil. I was kicking the devil every which way I could. And that's the truth. I mean, listen, it was no nightmare at all. He had the nightmare. Now, I don't know if I was out of the body or in the body. I don't know, but I know I was kicking his tail. I was whipping the devil. Man, I'm telling you, I saw him. I beat the devil up. As Paul says, whether I was in the body or out of the body, I don't know. Praise the Lord. But I know I came back, glory to God, and I said, man, this is good. And I got right back in the realm of the spirit. And you know, usually when you dream something, you try to go back and pick up where you left off. It's gone. I'm telling you, I pick right back up, and I start whipping him again. I mean, I whipped the devil good. I whipped the devil good last night. Right in my dreams, glory to God. Hallelujah. I was in the realm of the spirit. I whipped the devil good last night, glory to God. Now here's what I want you to hear. These seven ingredients or seven components that make up the same spirit of faith. Number one, hearing. Hear. You got to hear. Say hear.
Hear.
Number two, believe.
Believe.
Yeah, say it a little louder. Believe.
Believe.
So number one is what? Hear.
Hear.
Number two is what?
Believe. Believe.
Number three is speak.
Speak.
Yeah, see, because the same spirit of faith, believe and speak. But you can't believe it unless you hear it. So you hear, believe, and speak. Say it. Hear, believe, and speak. Now the fourth one is you see. See, yes. Yes, you see. So you hear, believe, speak, and you see what you speak. So you hear, believe, speak, what?
See.
I'm talking about the components that make up this same spirit of faith. And we're going to take time, if you would, with the next few weeks, just taking this thing apart. The same spirit of faith. I mean, the devil is in trouble. Glory to God. Hallelujah. The devil is in trouble. You wait till I go back to sleep tonight. I believe I'm a pig. Hallelujah. Glory to God. We hear it. We believe it. We speak it. We see it. Fifth thing, you got to receive it. You got to receive it. You got to receive it. You got the same spirit of faith not only believes something, it receives what it believes. So let's say it again. You got to what?
Hear it.
You got to what?
Believe it.
Uh-huh.
Speak it.
Yes.
See it.
Uh-huh.
Receive it.
And then you got to keep it. This stuff is preaching already. Glory to God. See, we want to see, take, and keep. Some people see it, but they never take it. The children of Israel, even Moses saw the promised land, but he didn't take it. Some people can see it, but they don't take it. Some see it and take it, but they do not keep it. We want to see it, take it, and keep it. Come on, keep it, keep it. Hallelujah. Now let's go through that again. Come on. You got to hear it, believe it, speak it, see it, receive it, keep it, increase it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. See, whatever God gives you, God is looking for the increase when you bring it back. Hallelujah. You got to increase it. See, faith, the same spirit of faith, this same spirit of faith and these seven components is what moves the very heart in the hand of God, because it's the spirit that's behind the word. See, I could have a word from God, but if I don't have the spirit of faith, even though I speak what I heard, but it's the spirit behind the word. Jesus said, the words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and they are life. See, words move you into the spirit realm. And Jesus said, the words that I'm speaking unto you, they are spirit. And the devil can tell not by the word that you say, but by the spirit that you say it in. He can tell whether or not that's a spirit of faith or a spirit of timidity. God has not given unto us the what? Spirit of timidity or spirit of fear. And the devil can tell, even though you may say what God said, but if the spirit behind it is not the spirit of faith, it's the spirit of faith that you got to say it in, because the force is with you. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Somebody better preach this when the force is with you. When you say the word of God, and the spirit of God that's behind that word. Hallelujah. Now, I need you to hear this, because we're going somewhere this morning with this word. And somebody's world is getting ready to be changed. Somebody's world is getting, and the thing I love about it, you'll see, you can do this, and God wants you to do this by the word of God. The same spirit of faith. Say it. The same spirit of faith. Now, let's hold that place here and go to the book of Romans. Go there for me. Romans chapter 10. The same spirit of faith. We're dealing with the mechanics, glory to God. The mechanics of these components. Hearing, believing, speaking, seeing, receiving, keeping, and increasing. And increase it. Glory to God. The same spirit of faith. See, faith, the spirit of faith can get you things money can't buy. Can get you a healing when the doctors have given up. And the doctor said there's nothing else they can do for you. No matter how much money that you have, the same spirit of faith can get you things money can't even buy. I said it can get you things that money can't even buy. But the thing I love about it, Tony, is the same spirit of faith. Not only will it get me things money can't buy, it'll get me things money can buy. Hallelujah. See, God wants your life, your world, God wants you to move in the same spirit of faith, whether it is a home, whether it is a car, whether it is a husband, whether it is a wife, whatever it is, the just shall live by faith. So God wants you to know that whatever you need in this life, the manner in which God gives it to you is called grace. You don't earn anything with God. But the hand that God gives you to receive what grace is given is called faith. And faith can get you things money can buy. Faith can get you things money can buy. And faith can even get you some money. Glory to God. Hallelujah. You can't stay broke walking around with a pocket full of faith. Oh, glory to God. Hallelujah. I said you can't stay broke walking around with a pocket full of faith. Hallelujah. The same spirit of faith. In the book of Romans chapter 8, once you're there, say amen. Amen. Romans chapter 8, look at the 13th verse. Romans chapter 8, verse 13. This is a review for some of us, but faith come by hearing, not faith come because you heard. I love this, glory to God. I'm probably going to give you some personal testimonies of how this certainly has worked in this preacher's life. See, I can have faith today, strong faith today, and next week not have the same faith. But in order for me to get the same faith that I had, let's say last year, when God moved me to give a supernatural offering, I need to go back and hear what I heard. See, faith don't come because you heard, it comes by hearing. And by hearing. But let's start and see if this process is right. We said first it's got to be the word, then it's got to be believing, then you got to speak it, then you see it, then you receive it, then you keep it, and then you can increase it. Verse 13, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. I love that. Verse 14, how then shall they call on him in whom they have not believed? Are y'all in chapter 10? Y'all did the same thing last week. After this week, I'm not going to let you do that no more to me. Don't do it next week. Don't do this next week. That's it. Last week you did the same thing. You should be in Romans chapter 10. Now, I'm not going to put up with it next week if you do that. I'm going to go right home. Chapter 10, verse 13. For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Verse 14. How then shall they call on him in whom they have not what? Believed. And how shall they believe in him in whom they have not heard? And how shall they hear without a preacher? And how shall they what? Preach except they be sent, as it is written. See, it's written again. As it is written, how beautiful are the feet of them that preach the gospel of peace and bring glad tidings of good things. Verse 16. But they have not all obeyed the gospel. For Isaiah saith, Lord, who has believed thy report? So then faith come by hearing, and what? Hearing by the word of God. Now, I said the components to this is first you have to what? Hear. Then you believe. Then you speak. Because it says that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But he's back in the process up to show unto us that whoever calls on the name of the Lord, like this morning and like in this service, people that would get saved. Whosoever called on the name of the Lord shall be saved. But he tells us they just can't call on the name of the Lord. He said, how can they call on him in whom they have not believed? And how can they believe in him in whom they have not heard? And how can they hear without a preacher? And how can they preach except God gives them the message and send them to preach it? So first of all, you start with hearing, because the preacher must preach. Now let me say this, because Jesus is the greatest preacher that ever lived. And he still lives today by the way of the anointing that's upon our lives. It's the anointed one that lives on the inside of us. But Jesus, in the body of his flesh, was the greatest preacher ever. And yet Jesus said, he that has an ear to hear, let him hear. So the emphasis was not upon his preaching. He knew he had the right word. He was the word of God personified. But he said that he that has an ear. So the burden of responsibility is not always on the preacher. The greater burden is on the hearer. Meaning based upon how you hear. Again, like Dana said, the value that you place on the word that you're listening to. I thank the Lord all the time that I'm not preaching to a jury. But I'm preaching to God's people, the congregants of the Christian house of prayer. So that we already know that the word has already been settled in heaven and God has sent it down. The judge has already passed judgment on the word. The Bible says the word has already been tried. God himself tried it and proved it, and it works. Now, the amazing thing is this, that the job of the preacher is to get the people to believe in what they say they believe in. See, all I need, Nicole, hallelujah, is to see it in the word of God. I already didn't told you I believe the whole book. See, Isaiah, we read it, and Curtis, it says, who shall believe our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Meaning that God has shown that he's a powerful God, that it's impossible for God to lie. Isaiah said, who's going to believe our report? So we have to settle that first of all. I believe the book. I believe the book. So that when I hear, but watch it now, when I hear what the preacher's preaching, my belief system is already on. Amen. See, I keep my belief system on. I don't wait until I hear it and then turn it on to see if I'm going to believe it. I already believe it. I just need to hear it. Oh, glory to God. I said, I just need to hear it. I already believe it. And see, when your belief system is already turned on, glory to God, then the Holy Spirit is able to move you like he did with Peter when Jesus said to all of them in the boat upon them, saying, Lord, if it be thou, bid me to come. And Jesus said, come. And only Peter got out of that boat and he walked on the water, but actually he was walking on the word. All he needed to do was hear it. And then his faith, see, faith was already alive in the man. Glory to God. So when you hear the word of God, your belief system is already on. I don't have to turn it on. It's already, that's why I'm called a believer. See, because faith comes. The text says faith comes by hearing, but faith comes, but it doesn't stay. David, thank you. I'm going to come on this side. I said, see, faith comes, but it doesn't stay. Faith comes and tag that person that believes. I already told you this. Now, please hear me. Only one out of four people are going to get something this morning from God. Only one out of four people are going to get something. I can't improve on Jesus' record. Jesus taught it, and Jesus said only one out of four people that heard him got something. That's what he said. And all four of them heard Jesus, but only one got it. So you got to determine right now, Sherman, start counting 1, 2, 3, 4. Find out which four are going to get it and send the other three home. See, if your belief system must already be on. Al, you got to have it turned on.
Yes, sir.
See, because when faith comes, faith tags the one who's believing. Now, if you were wrestling with this, faith doesn't stay long. Faith moves, it's like a magnetic pull. Faith comes, but faith finds it who believes. See, faith want to find believers. It's on the hunt. Faith is on the hunt. Faith comes, and it finds the person that's believing. If a person is doubting, faith moves. The assignment of faith, see, faith moves out on its name, and it finds who's believing. And so faith, that's the reason why you can have two people hearing the same word, one person get happy, the other person don't get nothing. Why? Because faith gives a high five to the one that got the word. Faith said, you believe it, glory to God. I said, faith, glory to God, hallelujah. So when faith comes by hearing. Hearing by the word of the Lord. And then when faith comes, it always comes to take you. See, faith comes, but faith never leaves you where it comes and finds you. Faith always finds you and take you. If faith don't take you, you have no business going. So when Jesus said, come, faith came and took Peter. See, faith takes you into a dimension of the invisible, or into the dimension of the supernatural, or into the dimension where all things are possible. See, but you can't go there without faith. Faith comes and takes you where all things are possible with God. No matter how things look, I'm going to show you right now. Faith said, I've come to take you into another dimension. I've come to open up a door that, glory to God, only God can open up, and he opens it up by faith. Thank you, Jackson. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Isn't it any wonder? Now, I'm preaching sound doctrine, Artie. And Jackson over there, he's got it. Glory to God. How do you know he's got it? See, I'm telling you, faith comes. You can tell when a person got it. The Bible says that the Apostle Paul was preaching. He was preaching to a crowd. You read it in your Bible. It's in the book of Acts. It says the Apostle Paul was preaching, and he looked at a man and saw the man had faith. It didn't say he said that he saw that they had, he saw that man had faith. And Paul said to the man was a cripple, and Paul said, stand on your feet. And the man jumped up and stood and started walking. Why? Paul saw the man had faith. So you can see, glory to God. Faith landed upon that man and said, go ahead and give him a word now. He'll step out on it. He'll do it. He's not thinking about it. He's a believer. It's already settled on the inside of him. Faith comes and takes you into a dimension, glory to God. Hallelujah, that the devil can't even touch you on that dimension. Now he says, now, so we have to hear, then you believe. You hear, believe, and you speak it. How can they call? How can they speak if they do not believe? How can they believe if they do not hear? So it starts with hearing, then believing, then you speak it, then you see it, then you what? Receive it, then you keep it, then you're ready to increase it. Don't patty cake, go ahead and give him praise. Hallelujah! All right, let's go back to the book of, or go forward to the book of 2 Corinthians. Hallelujah. Professor Krull, this stuff is wired, man. I'm telling you, I whipped the devil this morning. I whipped him good. I can't wait till I go back to bed tonight, Valine. I believe I'm going to pick up where, I mean, he was running. When I woke up, I didn't want to get up. I had him on the run. I was chasing him. Donald, I was chasing. I mean, I whipped the devil all night. Got up and went to the restroom and said, man, I must be dreaming, but it sure is good. Came back, and I mean, I picked right back up, whipping him. I was whipping him good. Whipping him good. Somebody's going to whip the devil. And you're not going to be dreaming. You're not going to be sleeping. You're going to take the spirit of faith of Almighty God, and you're going to chase him and run him out of your life. You're going to show them that you know how to fight the good fight of faith. And the Spirit of God's got your back. See, it ain't you fighting. Greater is he that's on the inside of you. It's a spirit of faith. And the devil knows he's not going to mess with God. The Spirit of God is on the inside of you. He backs up it. Hallelujah. Are you back in 2 Corinthians? 2 Corinthians chapter 4, once again, lift up your voice and declare verse 13. Come on. We have in the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. Now, this is important because we find the same spirit of faith believes and speaks, or in essence, speak what it believes, and then begin to see what it speaks. And always receive what it speaks and believes. Now, I need you to hear this, because the Bible teaches us that Jesus himself, he opened the book and he found the place, Deke, where it was written of him. Whenever, I said last week, Linda, we don't read the Bible reads us. And when you open up the Bible, like Jesus, you must find the place where it's written of you. See, that's what it's all about. Because then when you find the place where it's written of you, you see the witness and the testimony of others who have gone through what you've gone through. And then it gives you faith and confidence he's the same God. Sister, see, Hebrews chapter 12 says, we are encompassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Oh, man, I tell you, I'm feeling this. You get somebody that say, you know, man, this is impossible. I can't have no children. And then you say, you know, why? I'm too old. Sarah said, ho. Let me testify. You got witnesses. Everything you've gone through, they've gone through. And they'll stand up and listen. They'll stand up in heaven's court and say, wait a minute, let me testify. Turn over to such and such and such and read. Preacher, you don't know the hell I'm going through. You preaching all this and make it sound good. You don't wait till I see you at the service. I'm going to tell you what I'm going through. And then maybe you won't be preaching this kind of thing. It doesn't make a difference. It's in the book. God specializes in trouble. Now, I'm going to show you some of your snapshot right here. I'm going to show you some of your picture right here. See, God already knew. And this is what it says. This is chapter 4. Let's start with verse 3 first. For if our gospel be here, it is here to them that are lost. Do you see it? Good God Almighty. It's here to them that are lost. If our gospel is here, it's here to them that are lost, in whom the God of this world, or the God of this age, or the God of the cosmos. It's good to see you this morning. Praise the Lord. It's David's mother. She came to church. Mother's Day. Happy Mother's Day. The gospel, watch this now. When he said the gospel is here, it's here to them that are lost, because the God of this world, or the cosmos, he's not the God of the planet. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof, and they that dwell therein. He's the God of the systems of this world. He creates the fads of this world. Are you with me? So he said, the God of this world has blinded the minds of them that believe, watch it, that believe not. Verse 4, and whom the God of this world has blinded the minds of them which believe not, lest the light of the glorious gospel of Christ, who is the image of God, should shine unto them. For we preach not ourselves, but Christ Jesus the Lord, and ourselves your servants for Jesus' sake. Verse 6, for God who commanded the light to shine out of darkness has shined in our hearts to give the light, here it is, the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Jesus Christ. Here's your picture right here, verse 7. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels. Do you see it? Underscore treasure. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. The power may be of who? God and not of us. Now notice now, I'm going to show you a picture, but notice now, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels. Where's the treasure? It's in earthen vessels. Now I want you to hold your place there and go to the book of Matthew's Gospel, chapter 12. This is a topical study. It's not where I just take a text from its context. I'm lifting various verses of scripture, but it all is the thread that's being threaded by the Holy Spirit. It all deals with the same topic or subject. But in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 12, we have this treasure. And what Dana, Elder Holcomb was saying this morning, thank you, Elder Dana, for that word, 10 cents. Because if you read in the book of Mark's Gospel, chapter 4, and the 24th verse, if you read it in the Amplified Version, it says the value that you place on what you hear. See, the value that you place on what you hear will determine the victory in essence that you end up with in your life. So when Elder Holcomb gave us that about that 10 cent, we don't want to have 10 cent value on the word. Because we have this treasure, where is it? In earthen vessels. What is the treasure? Let me show you what the treasure is. And what a treasure is anyways, that which is precious and valuable to you, that which becomes the grabber of your attention, the motivator of your heart. And so in Matthew's Gospel, chapter 12, pay close attention now, verse 34. O generation of vipers, how can you being evil speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. You see it? Out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaketh. Whatever's in the heart abundantly will come out of the mouth eventually. It's when the squeeze is on. You don't know what you really don't know what's on the inside of you until the pressure's applied. Squeeze a lemon, what comes out? Somebody said lemon juice. That's a matter of opinion. It's not a matter of fact. The fact of the matter is, when you squeeze it, what comes out is what's on the inside. If you got poison also with the lemon juice, you get both. So it's only when the squeeze is on that you really see what's in the abundance of your heart. Now pay close attention to this. O generation of vipers, how can you being evil speak good things? For out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth what? Speaketh. Now watch this, verse 35. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bring forth good things, and an evil man out of the evil treasure bring forth evil things. But I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. Why? For by thy words thou shalt be justified, and by thy words thou shalt be condemned. Look at verse 35 again. A good man out of the good treasure of the heart bring forth good things, an evil man out of the evil treasure. So the treasure is what you put in your heart. The treasure is what you put in your heart. You can be healed today because of the treasure that you put in your heart. The healing word of God. You can be healed. You can be delivered. You, whatever it is, you change your world today. I thank God for that. That I can change. Hallelujah. I don't have to be a victim of the circumstances. God is telling me out of your own treasure. The words that God give unto me, Tony, he says, when you treasure this in your heart and from the abundance of your heart, your mouth is going to speak. But the treasure is what you place on the inside of you. You can speak evil things about your marriage or good things about your marriage. Now, I know, glory to God. Now, and listen, I'm certainly not trying to take all the credit. If I take credit, then I have to take the blame. But let me say this to you. You know, the average member say, I'm a good member. Yes, and you really are. Hallelujah. Because Valerie and I, we confess you that way. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I remember when we first started in the ministry, Valerie used to say, you know, if we had good members like this church or we had good members like that church, we could really do something. But we all start off the same way. God gives all pastors, when you start a church, he gives you the same kind of congregants that David had in the hole. David had people that was drawn to David. They were people that was in debt, people that were depressed. Hello. I mean, David had all these problematic people. When I started the church, glory to God, I was the bus. I had to go and bus my folk to church. They wouldn't come. Why? They didn't have a ride. I had to go and pick them up and then bring them to church and preach. If they had their own transportation, they wouldn't have came to my church. We didn't have a whole lot of desire. I mean, the walls was cold, cinder block floors, and so I had to go. And where did I find my congregation? I found them in the laundromat where people don't have cars. And they, you know, so I would go to the laundromat and witness to people. And they said, I can't come. I don't have a ride. I'll pick you up. I was the bus driver. Glory to God. I bust the folks in. Preach the word of God to the people. We preach the word of God to the people. We mold the people into the word of Almighty God. All we needed was people that would hear and people that would believe. And through that, people rose from the dust and from the dunghill. And people became blessed. People became prosperous. And nowadays, people mock us and persecute us and say, well, that church, everybody down there drive a brand new car. Everybody in that church got a brand new car. Do you realize the devil is the biggest idiot in town? Yeah. If he just leave folk alone. Do you know one of the reasons why the church is growing the way that it is? Because promotion comes out of, watch it, it comes out of persecution. And whenever you're being persecuted, that next level is your promotion. You cannot be promoted without persecution. You cannot be promoted, not by God, without persecution. Persecution is what brings you to the next level of elevation in terms of your promotion. See, if the devil just didn't say things against the Christian house of prayer, but the more he talks, the more God bless. The more he curses, the more God bless. The more he says, the more God bless. The more he keep on talking, glory to God. Everybody in that church is riding new cars. And do you know, some people get upset. They said, everybody got new cars. Everybody don't have no new cars. I said, is that what the devil said? For once, I'm going to agree with the devil. Glory to God. Let your possession become your confession, and your confession becomes your... We got even the devil blessing us. The devil is talking about we blessed. I said, you got the devil saying you're blessed. Blessed coming in, blessed going out, blessed in the city, blessed in the field, head and not the tail above all that, and not, you got the devil blessing you. Some of you don't understand, you got the devil even blessing you. Everybody got a new car. Everybody, well, here come mine, glory to God. I'm waiting for mine. Got the devil blessing you, the devil's blessing you, the devil's blessing you. People have come back. Everybody in that church got money. Everybody in that church got money. The devil's so dumb. Everybody in the church got money. He's blessing us. He's blessing us. He's blessing us. I want you to see this. I want you to turn back to 2 Corinthians chapter 4. We're almost ready to go. I can't take much more of this. I feel a rapture coming, David. Glory to God. The devil's dumb. Isn't he dumb? Isn't he dumb? He is the biggest idiot around. I want you to see this now. Are you back in 2 Corinthians chapter 4? 2 Corinthians, the fourth chapter. Please pay close attention to this. Hallelujah. I'm excited about it. Because we have the same spirit of faith. Now, here's your picture. I was hoping to get much further than this, but it is your fault. You know that, don't you, Earl? It is your fault. Okay, now pay close attention to this. Where I wanted to go this morning, we'll go next week. Look at verse 7 again. We have But we have this treasure. What treasure is that? The gospel, the light, the word of God, so that we can release it out of our heart, the treasure of our heart, and earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God, is not of us. We can't claim, if you would, that we've done this, that, and the other. It's the power of God. But here's your picture right here. Verse 8. We're troubled. Just stop right there. I read it this morning, Mother. I wanted to read the entire thing, but we're troubled. I see, that's my picture too, Glory. That's 90% of us in here right now. We're troubled. Only about 10% of you are not troubled. But wait, it's coming. Glory to God. you can't get promoted without. We are troubled. Now, this is the picture. That's why we need the spirit of faith. He says, we're troubled where? On every side. We're troubled on every side. But then he says, yet not distressed. See, the spirit of faith will take you somewhere. Even though you're troubled, you're not distressed. Why? We have the same spirit of faith. According as it is written, I believe, therefore have I spoken. We also believe and therefore speak. I can't wait, Holly, till next week to share with you in terms of this other dimension. Until then, we just got to hold tight and be still and know that he's God. But I'm getting ready to bring something to you that's going to cause you to, and listen, it's going to cause you to just to have a rapture. Some of you are going to pop right up out of that seat. I'm afraid to even share it with you right now. You'll jump up out of that seat. But now notice what he says. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. Then he says, we are perplexed. I don't know why all this is happening to me. I'm trying to live right, holy, but not in despair. We haven't given up. Then he says, persecuted, but not forsaken. Sammy, it's the persecution that the devil brings. Not forsaken, cast down, but not counted out. I'm going to close. But a fight, you know what? Again, I'm a boxing man, Michelle, I'm a boxing man. The fight, really, you really appreciate, you know, as long as a champion can duck, suave, and all that, and, you know, get out of the way. But what you really like about your champion is when he can take what he's dishing out. See, because some people can hit hard, and they can dish it out. But the question becomes, can you take it? See, it don't make you a champion because you can dish it out. But can you take it? When you're knocked down, you're talking about loving your champion. That is when your champion is knocked down and the referee is giving him his count. And he looks up and look in his corner and gets back up and can get back in the fight, Dana, and can take it to the one that knocked him down. I'm telling you, we have the same spirit of faith that raised Jesus from the dead. And as Jesus was knocked down 3 days and 3 nights, but he got back up. Glory to God. I say he got back up. And because he got up, you can get up also. You will get up also. You'll rise again. I say you'll rise again. You'll rise again. Somebody ought to give God a praise. Somebody ought to magnify the Lord with me. Somebody ought to magnify the Lord with me. You may be cast down, but you're not counted out. You're getting ready to rise again. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody ought to praise him. Somebody ought to praise him. Somebody ought to magnify the Lord with me. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All of us are in trouble. Persecuted, cast down, but we're not counted out. Why? You're getting ready to make a comeback. You're getting ready to make a comeback stronger than ever. He's given you his best. He's given Greater is he that's in me than he that's in the world. Father, we praise you. We thank you. We thank you, Lord, that we have the same spirit of faith that raised Jesus from the dead. And no matter how the enemy has cast down, but he can't count us out. For the same spirit of faith causes us to rise and, Father, to make a comeback. And everybody loves a comeback. We thank you, Father. Everyone loves a comeback. You deserve all the praise, all the honor, and all the glory. Father, your word says that many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord our God, you deliver us out of them all. And we're grateful. And we thank you for it. We give you praise.
Please join me as we confess verses 13 through 15 of the 92nd Psalm. Those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. They shall still bring forth fruit in old age. They shall be fat and flourishing. To show that the Lord is upright, he is my rock, and there is no unrighteousness in him. If you're in need of prayer, salvation, rededication, or church membership, counselors are standing by to take your call at 254-777-6292. Thank you.